perspective on self-control that I think connects it to policymaking, which is, I think, closer to what you study. So it's an attempt in some way to bridge between the two disciplines. But let us start from the beginning. What is a self-control project? So on the one hand, we all know what it is. It is when you are trying to diet, but then find yourself enjoying a dessert. That's a self-control failure. Or the conflict between dieting and indulging a dessert is a self-control conflict. Or when you the conflict between taking the painful medical intervention or skipping it and perhaps risking your health is also a self-control conflict. Or when students are conflicted between studying and watching their favorite TV show, it's also a self-control conflict. But on the other hand, not every conflict is a self-control conflict. So for example, if you are conflicted between two vacation plans, or if you are conflicted between freedom and achievement, like two personal values, these are conflicts, but these are not self-control conflicts. So on the one hand, we all know what it is, but defining it is a different issue. So how to define self-control is one problem. And then also, we all know that self-control is good, and this is corroborated by much research. Self-control, successful self-control, is associated with academic achievement, with financial success, with stronger interpersonal relationships, and better physical and mental health. And we know it from classical studies, and it's also there in more modern studies. So the second question is how to advance self-control. And these questions are related because the strategies how to advance or help people to better control themselves actually depend on how we define it. So there are answers to these questions. I'm not going to go over all of them, but only I'm going to kind of mention the central ones. The first one, I'm sure you know it, is the idea that self-control is a conflict between short-term goals and long-term goals, the smaller sooner versus larger later conflict, one marshmallow now, two marshmallows later, $100 now, $120 in a month from now. This idea had a run, so it's pretty successful. But there are others. The other one is that self-control is a conflict between affective or visceral motivations or action tendencies and reasoned or more cognitive action tendencies. So for example, should I act on my anger and yell at my colleague or perhaps reason through my options and perhaps come up with a better, more civilized response? Should I buy the good-smelling cookies in the supermarket, or perhaps reason through my dinner plans and stick to my shopping list, right? So this is some version of system one versus system two idea. And then we have the idea that a self-control conflict is about between automatic or impulsive habitual responses and responses that are new and they're more controlled responses.
Question. You don't have to take it, of course, instead of much, but I mean, acting on anger versus controlling it, it's not necessarily better to keep your anger inside.
Yeah, maybe. Keep it.
Keep it inside.
For you, maybe. That's a different problem. Let me continue, because I think that you maybe you're right. But this last one is very important to experimental people, to experimental psychologists, because under this definition, many experimental tasks are defined as self-control conflicts. For example, the stroke task. In this task, participants have to name the ink of the color of the ink of the word. So they have to say red when they see that, and they have to say red when they see that. But saying red here is much more difficult because we are habitual readers, and the automatic response here is blue because we habitually read words, and now we have to suppress this behavior, this habitual behavior, and come up with an unusual novel response. So under this definition, these tasks, and there are many tasks like that, become a self-control problem. So these are different definitions. What is a self-control problem? under one definition is not a self-support problem under another definition. For example, $100 now versus 120 in a month is not about affective versus cognitive, right? The stroke task is not short-term versus long-term. And it's not about affect versus reason. We have a problem here. So instead of all this, I would like to propose a different approach. And I would like to propose to look at self-control as a conflict between a policy and a specific action tendency. So I will explain it, and then I will try to show some research that I think supports it. And the research part is modular, so we stop whenever we are out of time. So what do I mean by policy? I think that's the crucial point here. I borrowed this from organization, from organizational thinking. And in social organizations, the outcomes of members' actions depend on the actions of other members. For example, the success of sales depends on research and development, right? And policies of organizations regulate the actions of the members in view of these interdependencies to optimize overall outcome. So for example, organize the work of R&D, sales, human resources departments together to optimize outcomes. So we take into account the interdependencies to come up with something that optimizes over these different actions in view of their interdependencies, right? So borrowing all this to intrapersonal conflicts and policies and actions, the idea would be that a person might have different desires or goals or action tendencies, and the efficiency of an action may depend on other actions. So for example, I want to slap my boss, and also I want to ask my boss for promotion. Now, if you look at these actions, that maybe asking for promotion would be less efficient if you slap her first, right? So a policy would regulate these actions in view of their interdependencies, and the policy might be something like first ask for promotion, then slap, not vice versa. Or it can be something like replace slapping with something that is less detrimental to later asking for promotion. Or it can be suppress slapping and ask for promotion, right? So these are policies that take into account the interdependencies. Now policies stand in contrast to disorganized action or to a state of no policy, right? A state of no policy is a state of disorganized action in which basically you slap the boss without considering how it would affect the efficiency of asking for promotion. Right, so you know that you want to do both, and you do one without taking into account the consequence for the efficiency of other actions that you might do or want to do or have a tendency to. In self-control conflicts, the policy is typically to suppress an individual action tendency that is deemed inconsistent with the policy. So you have a policy, and the policy is to suppress an action. Now, as I just said, it's not necessarily that any policy would be about suppressing something. And we will return to this point later, and maybe then maybe we'll legitimize the anger but of need. But typically in self-control situations, the policy is suppress something in the view of its effect on something else. And we suppress it either because it is inherently contradictory to the policy. So for example, eating a dessert undermines dieting, or you can suppress it because it competes on resources with a policy-favored action. So for example, watching TV is not inherently conflicted with studying, but it competes on resources, in this case, typically on time resources. So suppress it in view of the conflict, what kind of conflict, either inherent or conflict on resources. So what do we gain from this idea? One thing we gain is that it explains why in self-control conflicts, one side of the conflict is typically deemed wiser. So we somehow feel that the tendency to, or the desire to diet is wiser than the desire to eat, indulge in the dessert. And it's actually, it has been a philosophical question of which self to believe in. Why do we think that way? Why is it, is this the real self and the other one should be undermined? Why not vice versa? And here we have, I think, a better view or a better way to say why it is the case. A policy is superordinate to individual actions. A policy is mindful of the actions, but not vice versa. The individual actions are disorganized by themselves. They are organized only in a policy. It also explains that conflicts between two specific actions or two policies are not self-control conflicts. These are lateral conflicts, right? So you remember that we started with the this question in the what is a self-control conflict, so this explains why some of them are not. But more importantly, we have predictions that derive from this kind of thinking. One of them, so here is the definition again, policies regulate actions in view of their interdependencies with other actions. Now, one idea is that to appreciate the interdependencies of actions, we need to evaluate them on a common metric. We have to somehow make them talk to each other. And to do that, we need abstraction. We need abstract mental representation of these acts, of these policies. They have to be evaluated one against the other. And therefore, we can predict that abstract mental representation would promote policymaking and policy adherence, and hence also self-control. And here is and that's the first prediction. And the second prediction is that because policies regulate actions in view of other actions, and because a number of actions compared to a single action typically span a broader temporal, spatial, and social perspectives, then distancing in time, space, or social perspective would promote policymaking and policy adherence and also self-control. So here is ecological distance. It's always there. and this is the second prediction, that we'll get better self-control if we distance the decision in time, social perspective, space, or what we call contractual distance, which is make it hypothetical, make it less likely. Okay, so from now on, I'm into showing you studies. And the first one is on the effect of abstraction on self-control. And here it is how it goes. In one of the studies, we actually look at discounting of value over time. Participants in our study first undergo an induction of abstract versus concrete mindset. I will show you in a moment how it works. And then they indicate the dollar value of different outcomes, like a gift certificate or a restaurant, a DVD player that only tells you how long ago that was, and so on and so forth, that is received immediately or delayed in time. This is within participants from the balance. Let me walk you through the mindset induction. We use it quite, we and other people have used it quite often. If you are a participant in the abstract why condition, we sometimes call it high level, but it actually means abstract, then you receive this stem, maintain good relationships, interpersonal relationships, and you have to answer successive why questions. So why would you do that? So, and these are like the examples of possible answers. For example, I do that because I want to feel connected, and then you have to answer another why question. Why do you want to feel connected? You want to feel loved and wanted, be happy, and I want to whatever, get a purpose in life. And if the thing is that if you ask why questions move you upward in terms of abstractions. It is the question of why you do something, and it is more abstract than the step. So they go more and more abstract. And participants in the concrete condition also get a stem, the same one, maintain good relationships, but they have to answer how questions, how question. So how would you do that? Stay in touch with people, and how would you do that? Talk to them, and how do you talk to them? I use phone, but how do you use phone? I push buttons, and you see here that people get more and more concrete. So they either do one of them or a few of them, sometimes all at once, and then go through the experimental tasks. Sometimes we intersperse them. In this case, it was they do the manipulation, and then they evaluate the value of outcomes, immediate and delayed. And what we find in these studies is that you get less discounting. Lines are less steep in the abstract mind recognition. These are the solid lines compared to the immediate condition, which is the dashed line. So we get less intertemporal discounting under the abstract mindset condition compared to the concrete mindset condition. So the idea is that you get less discounting, right, which means that people value more the delayed outcome, which means perhaps that they would be better at self-control, right? So these are the applications with slightly different paradigms of delay discounting. If you are embarrassed by this one, but there are standard ones where people actually choose sooner, smaller versus larger later. There are many, many applications. But these are my favorite ones because here it was basically the same manipulation, but they looked at how much people save, people who want to save more and spend less, how much they succeed at saving. As a function of using an abstract mindset versus a concrete mindset. So an abstract mindset also helps saving. And if you, there are some studies on more standards or classic self-control exercising, so participants said that they would like to exercise more. They undergo a very similar manipulation. How do you improve your health, or why do you improve your health? And then it's a diary study. They report how much they exercise today over 1 week. And these researchers, this is actually my collaborator, but they show, but I'm not on this study. But they show that people exercise more after an abstract mindset. Right. More behaviors. This is flossing, again a manipulation of abstract versus concrete mindset, and unhealthy consumption of unhealthy food. Let me move all with this. Basically the same manipulation of abstract versus concrete. There is another one that is important, which is using wider categories or larger chunks of experience. And this is a classic problem, actually, in self-control. And it goes like that in many, many situations, a one-time behavior is actually not detrimental to self-control. For example, experts on smoking will tell you that if you smoke one cigarette, it has absolutely no effect on your chance to contract lung cancer. The system takes care of it. You can clean it up. It's not much worse than like breathing polluted air in like days of high pollution. You're not gonna. So that's not a problem. Now, so one of them is not a problem. One piece of chocolate is not a problem. You can exercise a little bit more later, and it's not going to add much to your weight. Now, if you always decide on one cigarette, right? So why ever stop smoking? That's the question. So if you look at one behavior one at a time, you would never do self-control. You would never cease smoking. And the idea is that in order to act according to your self-control goals, you have to look at this cigarette, not as this particular cigarette, but as smoke, as one in a series of similar behaviors that would eventually lead to smoking. And indeed, there is, like, in what is good about self-control is that there is a lot of literature on self-help, and they have strategies. And if you look at these strategies, you can learn a lot. Strategies on the one hand, and what makes you fail self-control on the other. So these guys know that if you are more likely to break a diet, if you think of the situation as very, very special. So if you come here and you say, okay, I'm on a diet, but this is a conference in Israel, and it's a very special situation, and it will never repeat itself. And therefore, I can eat. And so that's a typical logic that breaks self-control. So the more special something is, the more you see it as unique, and the more likely you are to break self-control. Or from our perspective, in order to act in according to your self-control goals, you have to see something as part of a category, and for that you need to identify it in more abstract terms as being not unique but part of the series. Right. So in order not to smoke the cigarette, you have to identify what you are doing not as smoking this cigarette, but as an instance of smoke. It's not this particular one, but it's one of the series. Actually, it's also good for animals. So this is interesting. And we looked at how chunking, actually, one way to induce high-level an abstract representation is to chunk things into larger chunks. Larger chunks are more abstract. So we looked at melioration. Melioration is an interesting piece. It is defined as a situation in which the value of a choice depends on its frequency. Classic examples are complaining. So each time you complain, you are more likely to get what you want compared to if you do not complain. But each time you complain, you wear off the efficiency of complaining a little bit, right? Or a child that cries, right? A child that is cries and makes a tantrum is more likely to get what you want compared to a quiet, obedient child. But they also wear off the efficiency of this strategy. So the more you use it, the less efficient it becomes. Or practicing touch typing is another classic example. It slows you down, but over time you build the skill, and the extent to which it slows you down reduces over time. And it is, in some sense, it's a self-control dilemma, ameliorate, complain, or avoid time versus appreciate the effect of choice on value and control. So this is like would be a policy that is conscious of the effect of this action on the value. So the experimental study of this paradigm is as follows. If you are participants here, you actually, that's what you see on the screen, you have to press A or B, you get a return, and you also have the total return. What underlies the choice is that if you press A, then you get N plus 1, where N is the number of A presses in the previous 5 turns. So for example, if you keep pressing A, then first you get 1, and then 2, and then 3, and then 4, and then 5. And then you keep pressing, you get 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, right? Because it's 1 plus the number of A presses in the last 6 turns. If you press B, on the other hand, you get N plus 3. Where N is, again, the same thing, right? So basically, if you press B, at any stage, you get more than if you would have pressed A at the same time. But it reduces your return for the next 6 presses of A. Okay? So that's a classic melioration. And the winning strategy is, so this is it, if you press A, and then shift to B, you get a little bit more. But then, you keep pressing B, and you get less, and if you have pressed A, you eventually you get more. So actually, the winning strategy is to press A all the time. Unless you know that you are really at the end of it, which our participants typically don't know. But people ameliorate. Ameliorate means that they are well, in some approaches they would say, short-sighted in our approach, they don't have this strategy. So this is the self-control option, and this is the temptation option. And we chunk experience. So after X trials, participants receive a summary of the last X trials. We don't give them feedback on how much they get for each press they receive, that they experienced already as they went through the test. But we do get tell them, in the last X trials, you pressed so-and-so times A, and the rest was B. And with and X varied from 5 to 150, and we thought that larger segments, they apply broader categories or larger chunks to experience, and therefore they make it more abstract, or they give you a more distal perspective, perhaps, on what you are doing. And this is the number of A presses as a function of the chunks, and you see that it increases with chunk size. Now, we don't give them actually new information. Yeah.
Question about that. So, would it be a winning strategy to do A's and then a B at one point and then go back to A? Because
no.
I don't know when I'm going to end. If I could, I would like to have a B at the end. But since I don't know when this point is ever going to come, because you can stop me at any point, I'd put a B some point just to jump and then go back to the A.
No, because the B gives you plus 2 relative to if it's not at the end, right? It gives you plus 2, but minus 5, because then you reduce the number of A presses over the last 5 trials 5 times, right?
Gotcha.
Okay, so much for the effects of abstraction and the larger chunks that can be seen as effects of abstraction. And let me tell you a little bit about the effects of psychological distance on self-control. These are actually classic effects. They're all over in the self-control literature. For example, spatial proximity of temptations reduces self-control. This is true in the classic Walter Mischel studies, the one marshmallow now versus the two later. A close marshmallow reduces self-control. Temporal distance is all over the literature. It is easier to pre-commit, for example, to a self-control action a longer time in advance. For example, people request informative but unpleasant feedback when it's far away in the future, but not when it's close by. This is, again, a classic self-control problem. Negative feedback is a self-control problem, right? Because it's to the extent that it's useful. So you trade off emotion with usefulness. Social distance, it is easier to advise another person to exert self-control than to decide on self-control for ourselves. So you go do a diet, why don't you do a diet? But I really appreciate the difficulty. So all these are, from our perspective, effects of distance. But that doesn't mean that it's not interesting to research it a little bit more. So here is a nice paradigm. This is first-person perspective versus a third-person perspective. So participants are instructed to visualize a situation from a first-person perspective. So for example, that's pretty much the instructions they get. They get also verbal instructions, but they see, think of yourself eating these candies from a first-person perspective as opposed to a third-person perspective, as if you are observing yourself from the other side of the table. And in this particular study, they invited participants to a mental imagery and taste. So they told them that they are interested in how mental imagery affects the taste of whatever products. And they let them, and they manipulated first person or third person, as opposed to a control that didn't do anything. And then they let them eat as much as they want from a bowl of candies. It's typically M&M's. M&M's are very popular in some research. Smarties, these were Smarties, but it's, you know, nobody knows. But in any event, what they show show here is that the third person perspective reduced consumption of these smarties. They ate less of them, and they reported less desire to eat them. So this is what we call a social perspective, a social distance. But let's look at this is a classic smaller sooner versus larger later. This is built on the failure as example, one apple now or two apples a week from now. And typically if you give it to people, they take the one now, not you, because you had as many apples as you wanted. But typically people take the one now. Suppose they take the one now, but now you introduce an initial span of distance to this problem. And the preferences reverse. So if you give them a choice between an apple in 4 weeks and two apples in 5 weeks, they take the two in 5 weeks. And of course, this is the classic preference reversal. And of course, people, after 4 weeks, they will be sorry about their choice, right? Because 4 weeks later, they will be in exactly this situation. What our approach suggests is that you can play this game cross distance, and that is a bit interesting. That's classic. I know you need people prefer the two apples later, not only if you introduce an initial span of time, but also if you introduce an initial span of some other distance. So for someone else, they should take two apples a week from now rather than one apple now. So I advise you to take the two apples. If this happens in a faraway place, so it's not really a time distance, but if I gave you you know what, you have to go to the other side of campus to get those apples, the one or the two, then all of a sudden people say, okay, I will take the two a week from now. Or in a hypothetical situation, that is what we call a hypotheticality distance or counterfactual distance, I would take two apples a week from now rather than now. So if it's preconditioned on something, and to the extent that this condition is less likely, so if I tell you if GANs forms that is not going to happen, but something that is, you know, fairly likely, say, now give me the one, then you will have to choose between one now and later.
The dice and then
right. So the less likely is the conditional. The more people are likely to choose the two apples later. And this is the game that we played in a series of studies, not only we but others as well. So we make people choose between $50 now and $65 in 3 months. This is hypothetical in this case, and in this. When these are NYU students, and if it is being cashed at NYU, they 49% of them prefer the larger later. But if you say, okay, it's going to be cashed in LA, they will send you the money. Then it's 71%. So they it's a preference reversal when we introduce like initial span of spatial distance. It is also true for an initial span of interpersonal distance. I take the larger later is 46% for me, but if I tell you what to do, then this percentage increases to 75. What is also interesting is that you can also play preference reversals, not over time, but over some other distance. And in this case, it's not one now versus two later, but it's kind of like one for me or two for some other person that I care about. So can we play this game with different distances? And the answer is yes. So for example, there is a social distance, discounting over social distance. We didn't invent it. It was invented by Raplin and Jones. Raplin is actually a researcher of animal behavior. He is famous for self-controlling pigeons, actually. But he did something that is... No, it's true. I mean, he's a behaviorist. So the idea here is that you trade off some small amount for you, somebody else would get. So you first create a list of people that are close to you in descending closeness. And people trade, of course, and you can play intertemporal distance. You can play preference reversals on that. So I trade, if it's here, then $50 to me, $50 to number five on the list is equal to 246 to number 20 on the list. But if we introduce an initial span, in this case of spatial distance, then it reduces to 173. So it's less discounted over social distance if we introduce an initial span of distance. So all these are very good games, but from our perspective, they actually show. And
can we open the floor for like 5 minutes questions?
One more thing. But so these are, from our perspective, effects of psychological distance on self-control. So let's go back to the general idea and look at some outstanding questions. Of course, there are many, many of them, but one of them is that I think is kind of lost with the other approaches to self-control, is that once we think about the policy, then of course the policy does not have to be to suppress the policy inconsistent action, and here is your anger. Because we know that policies of things that are in conflict can be a little bit more creative. So for example, you can compromise. For example, you watch only a little bit of TV and study most of the time. You need to suppress. Or alternate, you study now and binge on TV after the exams. And actually, there is research that shows that these are good strategies. So people who practice strategic indulgence, this is called in the literature, actually are more successful at self-control, but this is under research. And also, another idea that I think is worth pursuing is that if cognitive organization and social organization affect each other, this is a very old idea actually, but the idea is that the way our society is organized affects the way our cognition is organized. So is it the case that the way society treats violations of social policy shape individual self-control strategies? Or you can stretch it a little bit further and ask whether the different self-control strategies uncovered by psychologists help public policymakers deal with policy inconsistent actors. So for example, take distancing or take abstraction as a test case. But these are really like perhaps more abstract and far-fetched questions.